Gracious and loving God, we praise you and thank you for sending us Jesus, inviting us to join him in this great enterprise of salvation. May the meditations that we have this morning and through the week, and the words that we share, be pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Years ago, I was once told by a wise man who had observed my love of reading. He said to me, even though you have read all these books, you really don't know anything. I was surprised to hear that. It took me a long time to understand that my village neighbor was saying to me, not something to hurt my feelings or insult me. As a matter of fact, it was long after I left that rural village in Paraguay that I came to understand what my neighbor was saying to me. Again, it wasn't meant to insult me in my reading. The fact that I always had books in my backpack and could be seen reading a book under a tree or at a bus stop. What I learned from his message was this, that back at that time, I was a young man, very privileged. I was single. Even though I was a volunteer, I was being paid more than any amount that my neighbors could ever hope to receive. And someday I would return to one of the wealthiest nations in the world. I could come and go as I wanted. And so my young life was being experienced in my own reality, and my friend was trying to give me some words of wisdom. Not for that moment, but for some time later in life, when reality would change for me too. You see, I had yet to rub up against the rough edges, the jagged edges of life. I was just living a wonderful life. I was born into that world of privilege and a world of reality that was not of scarcity and limited opportunities. I was born into a world of a reality that offered me so much. My friend was not pointing out how I was flawed, but he was pointing out that I had not yet experienced the fullness of life. So I came to understand that powerful message that he was giving to me, that time brings knowledge and change. That time will bring knowledge and change. You get all types of book learning knowledge, but time and life experience will bring me the knowledge that will really hold me up in life, as well as change me. I think there's also the truth that our distant friends in other countries, family members that are living in faraway places in Africa, Latin America, and Asia, at times do not understand how difficult it is to be in this so-called land of opportunities. Arriving in the United States as an immigrant is far from the guarantee of a life of plenty. Many of you know that it takes hard work, sacrifice, coupled with faith and patience to live out life. Perception from afar is often blurred by a certain view of a reality that's just not true. Understanding the reality of another is really truly being able to walk in the shoes of another person. Our perception is just that, perception. To walk in the shoes of another person brings that reality into focus, but also brings change, and it brings change in life. Our gospel lesson this morning introduces two realities. The reality of Nicodemus, who's a devout Jewish leader, very religious man. Nicodemus is curious about how God is working through Jesus. But Nicodemus is also aware of his own reality as a Jewish leader, so he sneaks out through the shadows of the night. He did not understand the reality of Jesus, but he was curious. Jesus himself, he lived in a reality of God's freedom and mystery. Nicodemus, he lived in a reality where there was restrictions, there were limits, there were boundaries. He lived a very structured reality of a teacher of Israel. Nicodemus' life was very much focused on the temple. As a temple leader, he was concerned about all kinds of different aspects of temple life, from cult life to the matters of the economy of the temple, the sacrifices, the offerings, all that was necessary for this great enterprise to work. Jesus himself was concerned about faithfulness to God and the unfolding of God's reign, a very different reality. Nicodemus himself had read countless scrolls, but seemed to understand nothing about the life of the Spirit. Nicodemus was very much a man anchored in the religious life of the self, contained in the temple life. Jesus, on the other hand, he wanted Nicodemus to see beyond himself and to move into the new life and the new consciousness of the Spirit. Jesus wanted to free Nicodemus of the restrictions that he was living within. John Shelby Spong writes in his book titled The Fourth Gospel, Tales of a Jewish Mystic, that Jesus wants Nicodemus, and I quote, to escape his self-imposed boundaries. Wanted Nicodemus to be able to break through that which was holding him in a certain religious life. Jesus wanted him to be free and to be able to experience that life-giving power of the Spirit. Shelby Spong adds, and I quote, to be born of the Spirit is to step into a new dimension of what it means to be human. I love that image. To be born anew, to be born of the Spirit is to step into a new dimension of what it means to be human. Sometimes we think that, well, this is the way I am, this is the way I was constructed, this is who I am, and the boundaries that that make up who I am, that's it. That's the way it's hard to change. But we're not talking about just change here, changing of attitude or habits. We're talking about getting into a whole new dimension of what it means to be human. But God's Spirit can move us in directions and new ways of coming not only to understand God, but what God wants for the world and what God wants to do with the world. To be born of the Spirit is to be powered by the Spirit into a new reality, a new place, a new understanding of living, a new understanding of facing all that comes your way, and the reality that you live day by day, coming to understand that God's Spirit is a full and active force in your life, shaping you in ways that sometimes we simply do not understand. But in ways that help us to become fully human as God so intends us to be. And so what is this new reality? What am I talking about? Is it something that we can learn from a book? Or a study? In a small group? Well, not really. This new reality is really a call to just escape or let go of those self-imposed boundaries. Those boundaries that we put around ourselves and sometimes put around others. This morning, Deb shared with us a new opportunity to gather in small discipleship groups. And as I look at this study, and as I understand the study, and as I experience the study, it's a way to move us through prayer into another reality, a new way of being, not only human, but being a gathering of humans, the church. The purpose of the new opportunity is to experience the power of prayer. To experience the power of prayer in maybe a way that you've experienced before, or maybe new possibilities of experiencing the power of prayer. It's also a way of getting into small groups and circles of prayer and waiting on God's response to prayer. No guarantees that in the 4 weeks that you participate that God's going to do something miraculous, that you're going to see major change, but maybe you will. Or maybe you will see change through another person, or maybe you'll be tempted or to push forward to continue to pray and to pray these circles around your family, your children, an aspect of your life, and just to keep praying and praying and praying. And as the gospel says, that the praying, without ceasing, to go into that special place that you call your prayer space, your prayer room, and to be vigilant and vigorous about prayer. To call upon the Spirit, to bring that transforming force, that transforming change that you're looking for in your life. Yes, I believe that these small groups, these circles, will be an opportunity for us to let go of some of our self-imposed boundaries and to enter through prayer into some sort of new reality, some sort of new way of seeing your particular life, the life of your small group, or the life of the church, the life of what Jesus is calling you to be as a disciple. I believe that these small groups, these circles of prayer will be an opportunity to go deeper in relationship with God as we seek to go further in our shared ministry. We want the Spirit to power us to the next place that God has for us. We want the Spirit to power us to a place that we have not been before. We want the Spirit to lift us up, to carry us to the places that we imagine or we dream of going to, but they haven't been a reality just yet. First, we want to enter into that reality of possibility through prayer, to call upon God to answer the prayers and to help us to find ways ourselves to create our own answers to prayers. And obviously, this is not something new in the life of the church. You've all heard of prayer circles and prayer groups and prayer meetings, and this is not something new. What this is an effort to be more vigilant in small groups and to be something new within the church. Something new that allows us to bring in a new conversation out of these prayer circles. To see how we can be powered by the Spirit. And I believe that we have been powered by the Spirit. There's no doubt in my mind that the Spirit has been moving and working in this church. And always has been, and sometimes gone unnoticed, and sometimes very noticed. Brother Wilson at the church council meeting yesterday recalled how a number of years ago, the mission team, a small group of people, walked around the neighborhood. And we paused for prayer, we were observing, but at the same time we were handing out flyers to promote a program called Angel Food Ministry. Some of you remember it. It was a low-cost food purchasing program. A way for us to connect with our vision of being good neighbors. Unfortunately, Angel's Food failed us, failed the community, and failed itself. It shut down. And it left us without this opportunity. We felt that the Spirit was driving us in this direction, but we really missed the opportunity to provide a connection for ourselves and for the community through Angel Food. But you know what? God didn't give up. God understood that we had prayed for this vision, that we were prayerfully concerned about our neighbors, and that we wanted to find a way. God didn't give up. And sure enough, powered by the Spirit, opportunities and partnerships came. And they came in the size and in the force much greater than Angel Food. Much greater than Angel Food. Angel Food, I don't know, Rosemary, how many boxes were we distributed? 40 boxes. And they cost, I forget even how much they cost, 20-something dollars? 20 or 30 dollars. And you see how God said, well, if you want to be powered by the Spirit, if you're open to this, I'm going to give you more than you can handle. So you better get ready. I mean, powered by the Spirit means you let go of the boundaries, you let go of the restrictions, and you let God do God's work with you. And if you're not going to do that, if you don't want to let God do God's work with you, you got to be careful, because God might just go ahead and do it anyways. Uh-huh. And so what does God do? God fills the sails and the hearts of the people of New Covenant and says, well, here's an opportunity, here's a partner, here's a possibility. Go with it. See where you go with it. It builds this platform or gives us an opportunity to make those connections. You see, brothers and sisters, our job is this. To simply be open to the Spirit. And to allow life-changing winds of God to change us and lead us. If we open our hearts and minds to the direction of the Spirit, we don't know which way it's going to take us, which way it's going to come from, how it's going to be, whether it's going to be a strong wind or a gentle breeze. We don't know. But if we believe and trust in the power of the Spirit, we will be led someplace. We will be led someplace for the glory of God. And we will be empowered by the Spirit, not by our own genius and abilities and muscle or whatever, but by the power of God. New Testament scholar, the late J.B. Phillips, he wrote this book a long time ago, 55 years ago. Maybe some of you have heard of it. It's titled, Your God is Too Small. Tiny little paperback. When he wraps up his book, he concludes, and I quote, "The religion of Jesus Christ changes people." Let me say that again. The religion of Jesus Christ changes people. In parentheses, he writes, "if they are willing to pay the price of being changed." You get that? The ministry of Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit changes people. But there's a price that comes. I think it's dropping down those boundaries, those limits that you think we have. Oh, we can't do that. We've never done it that way before. So on and so forth. But when we drop down those boundaries, we open up that space, we find that the Spirit takes that place. He goes on to say, the religion of the Jesus Christ changes people so that they quite naturally and normally live as sons and daughters of God. And of course, this is the community part. Of course, they exert an excellent influence on the community. Our mission statement is about creating and nurturing disciples of Jesus Christ through the work in the local church, the community, and the world. We've been very good about being sons and daughters of God and exerting influence on the community. Now God is calling us to get back to this mission statement of the creating and nurturing of disciples. Creating and nurturing of disciples. That's the work that Jesus did first. He called his disciples, he created them, he nurtured them into the ministry of putting them into community so that they could influence them. We've been following that model. But now is the time to start strengthening the work of creating disciples so that the work is sustained, the work continues. And by the way, the Spirit will come and influence new disciples and nurture them as those who will be creative and redemptive in the work. All kinds of new possibilities will emerge. A long time ago, when we were just little sons and daughters of God, we were introduced to the religion of Jesus Christ. As children, many of us were taught about the love of God and how Jesus made God's love visible in the world. And early on, at least in my introduction, and I imagine in the introduction of many of you to God, Jesus as well, we were required to memorize Bible verses. I didn't like memorizing Bible verses. But every day I went to Sunday school, I would have to come back with these little cutouts and an assignment to memorize the Bible verse. And I would do it, and I'd have to go back to Sunday school, and I'd have to show my teachers that I memorized it. Somehow I would stagger through the exercise. But there was one that always stuck with me. That John 3:16, did it stick with you too? It would always stuck with me. Even in the days when I was just kind of floating around the periphery of the church as a young person, John 3:16 was on my heart. I never forgot those words. And all the different translations that it came. And so early on in our introduction to God and Jesus, many of us were required to memorize these words of John 3:16. And later we learned to read the words of the gospel on our own. We got to go further beyond John 3:16. But while we read these words, we could not, as young people, fully understand the new reality this new reality of John 3:16. It was hard. We memorized it. It was packed into our minds and somewhat written on our hearts. But this reality that God so loved the world, it would take time for us to understand. We'd have to live through life and rub up against those jagged edges of life and to really understand that the power of God's love for us. Life has a powerful way of teaching us the limits of the human experience, the fragility of the human experience, the brokenness of the human experience. Life has all these ways of showing us what we think we are, but we really aren't. And life has all these ways of inviting us into all these different dimensions of life that really are not helping us evolve into the fullest of humans that we can be. And out of this experience, God enters. God enters into our lives. Founded on John 3:16, so loves us, so loves the world that he gave his only son so that we could come to understand a new reality in life. A new reality. You understand what I'm talking about? Eternal life. Eternal life. Can you grasp it? Can you grasp it? To live life on earth, grounded in the power of the Spirit that introduces us and presents to us the real possibility and the truth of an eternal life. And when we enter in this reality of eternal life and understand that everything that we do in this life can be powered by the Spirit, can be visible signs of God's love directed by a Spirit. And how do we get there? How do we come to discover this great possibility? How do we make this intersection between this earthly life and eternal life? It's that great conversation that we have with God day in and day out. Prayer is an opportunity. Prayer allows us to lay it all out. God already knows what's going on, but prayer allows us to lay it all out. God, this is what's going on with me. You know it. I know it. But I need you. I need you to speak to me. I need you to send your Spirit upon me and guide me, because I'm laying it all out, all the fragile brokenness of me. Prayer is an opportunity for discovery. Prayer requires us to at least consider, if not enter into this new reality of Jesus. It's not laying out a laundry list for Jesus and for God to take care of. It's a way of entering to a place, a new reality. A reality that gives you an understanding not only of eternal life, but the power of what God can do with you. While we can read books about prayer, we must remember God is not limited by paragraphs and pages. God is meant to be known and experienced in the waiting and in the maturing, in the prayerful observation of what God is doing around us. And it's there where we'll get the signs of eternal life, of God's saving love. Well, since my wise old friend introduced me to the lessons of life, I've read a lot more books. Probably still not any smarter, but I've read a lot of books. I'm still learning from the great authors. But the author of life, has been working me over since the very beginning. It's just that this man, this peasant that was walking down the dusty road, who came up to me and put his hand on my backpack where the books would be, was God saying, you know, my son, you read a lot of books, but you don't know anything. God would walk with me. While this man who gave me that comment would fade into the past, God has stayed with me, resting God's hand on me, guiding me, and empowering me by the Spirit to move forward. And I know that God's doing it with you too. Do you feel it? Have you felt the Spirit guiding? The hand of God resting on your shoulder. Nudging you this way or that way to that place where you didn't want to go, or just simply letting you know that there's more to know. There's more mystery than this knowledge. A powerful Spirit leading us to places we thought we'd never go to. And a powerful Spirit that's changing us into people we never thought we would be. And most importantly, a powerful Spirit giving us eyes to see a new reality, a new vision. And I'll refer a little bit to this, talking about the trustees having met years ago and wondering if the building would ever have a reality that you were almost given up on. But God didn't give up on you. God didn't say, well, Burnside United Methodist Church, well, you've got a reality, you envision it, but may that be the one that you're thinking of. I might have something new in store for you. By God, God did. Powered by the Spirit, things happen. And so this may be your personal story too. Are you curious, like Nicodemus? Are you longing for God to bring change into your personal life? I know I am. What matters here is that we continue to be that vessel that's not afraid to hoist the sails. The sails of faith that open up wide so that the Spirit, whichever direction it comes in, can fill those sails. So the billows are just all wide open, and we don't know where we're going. We have a compass in Christ, but we're not sure where we're going. I think what matters most is that we're willing to hoist the sails so that God's Spirit, God's power can take us to new places in our own lives, in our family lives, in our work lives, in our church lives. I believe in the power of the Holy Spirit. It's led me to places. Led you to places. You will lead the church to places. We're not all will go well. But one thing I know, that there will be goodness, even in that which does not go well. Because God has God's plan. It's stated in John 3:16. It's a plan of love and a plan of promise. A plan of love and a plan of promise. A plan that defeated the grips of death. A plan that promises that if we continue to work faithfully and to stay open to the Spirit, we will see miracles. Things will happen that we could never imagine before. Just as Nicodemus, farther down the gospel trail, would see things he never thought he'd see before. May we go into the world open in the direction of the Spirit. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, let your Spirit fall upon us. Open wide our hearts, O Lord. Empty us of that which we don't need and fill us with that which we need. Guide us with your Spirit. Help us to let go of our stubborn borders and boundaries, so that we could be a bit more open to the direction that you have for us in our lives. Let us not hide under the shadows of doubt, but let us open our arms wide and our hands open to what gifts and opportunities you will have for us. Let us not be afraid of the Spirit, but to welcome it, so that as we go into the world this week, we may be true representatives of your love. Through Christ Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen.